So, hi all, my name is Barak Itkin, and I'm going to talk about ORMs and advanced Python. And if ORMs doesn't mean anything to you, we'll get to that in a second. So, firstly, just quickly a short bio. I'm a computer vision researcher, and I was and still a software engineer. You don't lose that skill eventually. And I'm teaching at Tel Aviv University, and I'm writing quite a lot of Python, and that would probably be an understatement. So, motivation, or why are we here? So, every person who have ever worked with a database have seen this sort of SQL boilerplate. You have seen an insert query or select query or so on. You have seen the list of all the columns from the DB inside of your query, and then you have seen essentially exactly the same as part of your actual code, because the name of every field was repeated both in the query string and the code, and then this causes lots of duplication. This doesn't seem so bad when you're running just with one object type with three fields, but with actual production systems with hundreds of types of objects and dozens of fields per object, this is quite bad, and it becomes really hard to maintain when the project goes on and has more fields added to each object. With an ORM, this is usually much more trivial, and this looks essentially like an insert call. There is some library behind the scene that takes care of generating the query based on the fields of your object and essentially just adds that and maps that into read and write queries from the DB. Now, to answer the question of are there any SQL ORMs in Python, yes, obviously there are. I'm not trying to reinvent the wheel. There is Django, which is probably the most popular one because it's part of also a bigger web framework, which is quite popular. And we have SQL Alchemy for those who prefer working with SQL alone without the other overhead. And there are in fact many more, which raises the question of why are you here and giving us this talk when we can use an existing library? And the answer to that is that not every database is SQL-based. And specifically, we use graph databases, and we have a semi-legitimate use case for using that. And graph databases are accessed via a language called Gremlin. And the role is to also enable us to store relations between entities and between any two entities across any type of table, which is something which is quite hard to achieve properly with foreign keys in SQL. So a typical Gremlin query also enables us to have more power. So for example, I could start with a graph, and I could then go over all the vertices in the graph. I can filter vertices to have only the vertice containing the property name and, for example, Robert Downey Jr. I can then repeatedly follow outgoing edges of the type acted with while only maintaining a simple path, meaning without having any sort of repetition in my path. And then I can stop when I reach a node which has the name of Kevin Bacon. And by returning the path and computing the minimal length of all such paths, I can obtain the Bacon number of Robert Downey Jr. So this may seem like a toy example, but there are obviously much more concrete use cases, and note the expressive power we had in this sort of query. We were able to express concepts as a simple path only because of our choice of the DB engine, and this is the sort of thing we want to use. So Gremlin boilerplate isn't very different from SQL boilerplate, it's just having different syntax. You begin with the graph, you add a vertice, and then you set all the property values again. You have a string for every property name, and then you have the code reference for the exact same property, and then finally you run the query. So we were searching for Gremlin ORMs for our DB, and specifically our DB was called JanusGraph, and we reached the very optimistic conclusion of zero results whatsoever in Stack Overflow. This query still stands as of yesterday. There are zero results on that. And we were left there to wonder on our own about our life choices to realize whether we are using the right technology for the job. But as researchers, we probably wanted to spend more time actually using the technology and not doing a very big market research about what's the best technology and how to use it. So we decided we can probably do it ourselves, and we decided to roll our own ORM. And surprisingly, it took about a day to reach an ORM, and we realized that this is probably worth sharing. So our motivation today and our goals are going to be A, we want to create a system that enables us to enforce data type and schema as we do when storing data in most databases. And we want this sort of enforcement not only to happen when we are inserting the objects into the DB, but rather when we are assigning the values to the different fields of our objects. We want to catch errors as quickly as possible, and not only 300 lines of code later when someone has the liberty of inserting it into the database. Secondly, we want to reduce the boilerplate to minimum, and minimum means zero. We don't want to write any sort of Gremlin query by hand because this is tedious, doesn't scale, and is very error-prone when more fields are added. And finally, we want to have fun with Python. We are all here because we enjoy this language, and we are trying not only to learn something new, but also to do it in a fun and expressive way, which would enable us to do more things later. So the final result we are trying to aim for in this talk is to obtain the following. We want to be able to define a class where all the members of the schema are already defined as members of the class namespace at the root. We don't want to define these as part of the dunder init method when we initialize each object. Furthermore, we want to add annotations to each sort of field in the schema. We want perhaps the data type, or whether it's required or not, or all sorts of other attributes that may pop up with the specifics of your own database. And to do that, we first of all need to realize how attribute access actually works in Python. So here's a quick reminder. When we try to access an attribute, we first of all go to the dunder dict of the instance. This is some sort of a namespace where values are stored by name for the specific instance and regardless of the type. If we don't find the attribute we're trying to access in the dict of the instance, then we follow the same process, but this time for the dict of the class and all the other classes in the hierarchy which may be inheriting from. And here is where the magic happens. If we found in the class dunder dict something that implements the descriptor protocol, which we'll detail in a second, we can do quite a lot of fancy schmancy things, and we'll get to that in a second. And if not, we continue with other dark magic in Python, such as getAtter, and so on and so on. So we're here because, first of all, we're interested in the descriptor protocol and how it can be accessed efficiently to save us writing code. So let's go over the descriptor protocol. The role of this protocol is to enable us to have custom code running when we are trying to get and set attributes inside a specific instance. And the way it works is by defining a get method, for example, when we want to read an attribute. If an attribute is resolved to something implementing the descriptor protocol on the class level, and that thing implements the dunder get method, then we will call this get method whenever someone tries to access this attribute for reading. In a similar fashion, we can define the dunder set method to be invoked whenever someone is trying to set this attribute, which was resolved to the descriptor on the class level. We also have the dunder del method, which does what you think it does. And if this notion sounds familiar, of I don't want to actually have properties or values, I really want to be running code, then this is familiar because this is how the property decorator works in Python, and this is most of us something we already use. The thing is that the property decorator is actually implemented behind the scene with the descriptor protocol, and finally understand how to leverage this thing correctly, we should have much more power and much less code that we need to write on every property access. So back to descriptors. This was our end goal. And what we said is that if an attribute access resolved to something defined in the namespace of the class, then this object in the class level is going to be checked for the descriptor protocol. So what we already saw is what are going to be our descriptors. These are the entity property objects that we define on the class level, and all we need to do is to implement the descriptor protocol for these objects. So the descriptor implementation is going to be quite straightforward. We're going to define an entity property class, which is just like any other class in Python, nothing fancy. And for example, I wanted to store the data type, required attribute, and so on, and I store these as part of the entity property object. And I also have the name here, and the name is going to be the name where I'm going to store the value in the dunder dict of the instance. This will get clearer in a second. So actually implementing the descriptor protocol, on the same entity property object, I'm going to implement the dunder get method, which is going to just go to the instance and to the dict of that instance and fetch the value with the key name. In a similar fashion, we can implement the dunder set method, but here is where we can start hooking up all of our custom logic. So for example, we can check whether data type was actually specified, and if it was specified, we can make sure that the value that is being passed to be set on the attribute is of that specific data type. If not, we can throw an exception right now instead of waiting for later. remember this place as we will be returning here in a few minutes, because this is where we can start hooking up all sorts of crazy logic to implement more functionality in our ORM. Finally, after doing the validation, we do the obvious action of storing the value in the dict of the instance with the key being self-name. So right now, we define this user entity class, and we had the entity property defined on the class level, and we sort of wanted to have the value nickname stored inside the dict of the instance as nickname. But note that I haven't written the string nickname again in the constructor of the entity property, because that would be code duplication, and we are here trying to save code. So what we can actually do is use some of the custom logic that was implemented in Python 3.6 with the dunderSetName method, which is not properly documented on the Python API. And that method actually enables us to have something called whenever the class finished its definition. Meaning that when we define class user entity, all of the body of the class is evaluated as a regular Python program. And once we finish that and call the initialization, of the actual class object, then what happens is that every descriptor object have the dunderSetName method being called for it automatically with the name of that value in the class level. So here what we're going to do is, instead of having two things called nickname and having some sort of ambiguity, we're going for this specific instance to have it stored as underscore nickname. So the value nickname on the class level would be stored in the instance as underscore nickname. And now metaclasses. No PyCon lecture can be complete without metaclasses, unfortunately, and we actually do need them in order to achieve our goal. And specifically, metaclasses should be thought of as the classes of your classes. And if that sounds recursive, then yes, you are correct. Try searching for recursion in Google and seeing what you get. Anyway, so if we think about it as Bob equals user construct is an instance of the class user, and then the class user is also an object, and that is also an instance of a different class. So the class user by itself is an instance of the class called type. So the default meta class, or the default class of your classes, is type. Like every other class in Python, you can construct custom instances of that. So we can construct custom types on our own, and we can roll out to do quite some fancy things. And to do that, we need to realize what are the arguments that the type constructor expects. So the arguments themselves are the name, the bases, and the namespace, where name is the name of the class we're wishing to create. Bases is a list of all the other types we want to have as base classes for our class. And namespace is just a dictionary of key value, which results from evaluating the body of the class, typically. So how this works requires us to also recall how objects are being created in Python. Most of us would think that the dunder init is the constructor of a class, and this is incorrect. The dunder init method is the initializer of a class, meaning that once an object was already created, and we usually refer to it by self, the self object is then customized with the dunder init method. But this is not where the object itself is actually being created. The object creation is done in the dunder new method, which most of us have never had any legitimate reason to use except for feeling smart. So the dunder new method is actually what creates the object, and it's mostly usually just create the empty container we call an object, and then calls the dunder init method with the arguments passed through. But we can actually use the dunder new method and override it, for example, to create a singleton. We can, in the first time, create an instance of an object, and then on every consecutive call to dunder new, return the same instance. By doing that, we will actually have only a single instance of our class without the ability to create more instances of that class, which is exactly what we wanted in the notorious singleton design pattern in every job interview ever. So we can customize classes by overriding either the dunder init method or the dunder new method, and then interfere in the way in which classes are created. And this is exactly what we want to achieve when we are trying to generate code and save ourselves some boilerplate. So one thing we would have to do in order to generate all the queries automatically is to somehow collect all the properties when the class is being created. So we're going to do this by defining a new metaclass. Our metaclass is going to be defined by inheriting from the type metaclass, and it's going to define the done the new method, which received the name, the basis, and the namespace, and also, for technical reason, the reference to the metaclass itself. We can then go over the namespace of the class and collect all the values in the namespace which are an instance of the entity property class. Because eventually, when defining a class, we evaluate its body and then we call the type constructor. So the type constructor is invoked with the dictionary of the namespace of the class. It has entity property objects, and we can just collect them into one dictionary we call properties. Once we did that, we can inject that into the created class by creating a new namespace from the original one, which also has this dictionary of all the properties being stored with the surprising name properties. So all the properties of the class are being stored as a static class level member called properties. And once we did that, we can call the original constructor of the type. But instead of passing the original namespace, we pass the new namespace, which is augmented with yet an additional member, a dictionary of all the properties defined inside the class. But this is not enough. We actually need to connect this somehow. And we do this by, first of all, defining the metaclass. And then for code looks reason, and we want our code to be well designed, we're going to define a base class of entity for all the entities in the database we want. And that class is going to explicitly specify that the metaclass we are using is not the default type, but rather the entity metaclass we previously defined. And then we're going to have every entity of our database just inherit from the entity class, as metaclasses are also used to construct all the subclasses of a specific class. Then we don't need to explicitly specify the metaclass for every entity we're going to later define. But we can do more than that. We can also save ourselves code instead of writing the initialize method every time again and again. So we can create the dunder init method in a similar way, assuming it was not already defined. We can define a generic init method which receives all its arguments as keyword arguments. And then it's going to go over every specified keyword argument in the intersection of the properties already defined on the class level. Once we do that, we can fetch every property by its name according to the keyword argument and invoke directly the set method of the descriptor with the value of the keyword argument. Once we did that, we need to, as best practice, to call the super initializer of the class, because we may have the case of multiple inheritance. And when we are done with that, we can just inject this into the new namespace we defined before. If dunder init is not defined, we can add the generic init method, and then we can return the class. And while this seems to be pretty simple, unfortunately, this doesn't work. This doesn't work because super in Python without any arguments doesn't work the way you think it does. Super without any arguments in Python, in fact, relates to the class in which the method was defined. And we define this generic init as part of the class called entity meta. So the super here without arguments is actually going to refer to the entity meta class, which doesn't make sense at first, but this is how it's implemented behind the scenes. So to solve this, all we need to do is to store the reference to the class being created from the class construction in type done the new, and then call super explicitly with the class object and the self as we had with the old syntax in Python 2. This would work without any additional surprises, but if you try the previous, this is going to yield cryptic errors that you have no chance of whatsoever decrypting and understanding. So, finally, we need to generate the insert method because I promised an ORM. So we have the entity class which we just defined, and we can define here the insert method that would receive the root of the graph we want to insert to. We're going to create a new query of type addVertex, and then for every property defined on the properties of the instance on the class level, we're going to have a call to the property call of the query, and then we're going to specify the name and fetch the value via the descriptor defined again in the properties dict. Finally, we can just call query.run, and that's it. No boilerplate whatsoever, and we have all the queries generated automatically for all the types of objects. So the end-to-end usage would be define a user, for example, here. We didn't need to define the constructor with all the fields because we got that automatically. And we would have the insert method and no manual Gremlin boilerplate whatsoever. And you can apply this to every DB of your choice instead of always writing the manual queries. So the next thing we need to touch is actually Python delicacies and data types. I actually asserted that the value I got was of the data type specified in the entity property. And that's actually a big no-no in Python because you should not be checking types most of the time. For example, the value 2 could be an instance of float and we want to store it in a field of type int, but we shouldn't really care about that. If the value is compatible to be an int, we should just be storing it. So what we really need to do is to check whether the value is not of the data type. And if it's not of the data type, we want to try and cast it to the new data type to check whether the casting actually hasn't changed the value one bit. And if the casting was actually okay, then we can take the value as a result of the actual cast. And that's the proper way to do it in Python. So the code is actually a bit ugly because of how Python handles types. And you need to do the casting yourself in order to avoid conversions later in the insertion to the database. This also gives us some opportunities to hack things. Once we implemented our own ORMs, we can do really fancy things. For example, we can define complex types such as coordinates, which is a pair of long and lat, and then we can define the user entity also with a location, which is with this complex type coordinates. This would eventually be mapped later to a property which has the combined name of loc.x and loc.y. And this is actually quite trivial to implement, and the reference to that will be on the GitHub later after the talk. But this is one of the benefits of implementing our own custom ORM. We can roll out all these sort of crazy hacks. And there are also opportunities to hack in array support. We can, for example, have DBs that don't support arrays actually support them by having arrays pickled and unpickled on the loading and saving of the actual data. We may also want to store the shape of the array depending on what and how we are doing it, but once we are in full control of what actually goes to the DB, we can transparently implement array support and even array of complex type support, which is what we already implemented in our own ORM. Further considerations, just quickly. This is not really a full ORM. You need to validate all the required fields to make sure they actually have values, which should be trivial at this point. We also need to realize that daytime objects in Python are notorious and don't have a time zone. So you need to convert them, for example, to UTC time zone and only then store them in the DB because the DB usually doesn't have a time zone. And you also need to set the primary key of every object after you insert it into the DB. These all aren't too hard to do, and by this point in the lecture, you should have enough information on how to move on with implementing them. So in about one day of work, you should be able to implement your own ORM for any database of your choice. And that was my talk.
Thank you very much.